What's up, guys? Here we are back on Wind Chaser. We're just rolling some ground. We sold all of our bean and corn. Had a great demand. So we're doing pretty well on money. We're right around 1.1 million. We sold off our old ATI 450, and we purchased a T9 700. We sold off our 2720 disc rippers because we're going to be buying a 2730 next year. Traded in one of our T600s. And we're probably going to purchase a CT660. We're just trying to decide on color. I think we're going to go with dark gray or yellow. That dark yellow. Hopefully Sirius Mods can get some nice American trucks from ATS converted. Wouldn't mind using that 900L Kenworth. Day cab with the triaxle configuration. Anyways, with our dual 36-foot trailers, we were able to sell all of our soybean. It was like 790,000 liters of beans. Got about 404,000 from that, and then that really jacked up the price of corn. We also had a 2.0 multiplier on corn. So it's just nice how they both kind of populated at the same time. 24-hour great demands. But we were able to do 1.5 transport, 1.5 million. liters of corn, and we only sustained like 20% damage on our rig, on our trailers and trucks and stuff like that when we were hauling in. Did a little bit of road work because some of the roads are really rough. So what I did is I just kind of smoothed those out a little bit, so it makes driving a little bit less damaging. I mean, if you're on a county highway road that's paved and everything, you shouldn't be sustaining any kind of vehicle damage at 55-60 miles an hour. So I kind of smoothed out, redid some of the roads in some places. So hopefully that will make our train tracks kind of like move the train up so the train tracks weren't as damaged either, because if you go over the train track at like 10 miles an hour, you get like 4% damage just because it makes the suspension go all crazy based on giant's physics. Anyways, it was a nice dry run. We were able to do driving more conservatively, slowly going a further distance. We actually transported over 100,000 more liters than what we previously did with dual 43 Ford Wilsons, using the 36 foot Wilson trains. So nice to know that those are practical and work well. And we're having some dry days coming up, so we're putting moisture back in the field. This roller has pretty much the function of it is just to replenish moisture. I guess you could pretend that we're pushing in rocks, flattening the soil for better seed soil contact. Our drapers will be all happy and stuff. Right now, it's pretty fun to use. It's always fun to use new mods after I worked on it. I mean, I started this land roller like a month or two ago and just finished it. Just because we finished up landing, so kind of gave me a little bit of motivation to stop working on my 2730 and finish this project up. For such a basic function in game, it's actually a fairly complex mod, a lot of interesting scripting going on this piece of equipment. We're using our 450 row crop now because we wanted to get the hours. So I wonder if I can actually hire off this worker. So if we load cores 19, we size it to, I don't know why this GPS does funny stuff. It's clearly 14 for me to work with. So, there's some smaller land rollers in game. This is a 45 foot. Could have made it 50 foot, but for whatever reason, just went with 45. The main reason why it kind of took me so long or I lost motivation in this is because there's not a whole lot out there for pictures to kind of study and model this, so anytime you don't have a good picture, it makes it very time consuming to model, because there's just nothing to reference, so you're just kind of guesstimating, and then when you finally find a picture, you find out that you actually made it wrong. And so I just try not to go too heavy or like try to model too much unless I have good pictures, good visualizations, or I've seen the implement before and know exactly what it looks like and how it folds and unfolds, stuff like that. So I was actually looking at some research. I mean, I guess you could call it research. It's more of a editorial or surveys or stuff like that. I mean, nothing that is you can come to a causative conclusion. You know, the level of studies in agriculture are basically what we in science we would call a retrospective study. It's retrospective longitudinal studies, but the only issue is it's very poor to control systemic error, and it's very hard to make control groups and eliminate a lot of that systematic error in your study. So that's why a lot of agriculture studies, unless you're doing in vivo or in vitro study of agronomy, like plants and stuff like that, it's really damn near to have anything that's scientifically significant. Not that it isn't significant, it's just statistically insignificant because there's so much error that they didn't account for in their study, as compared to their control group, which their control group is also has systemic error. So when they're trying to compare like yield with land roller versus non-roller, there's too many other variables that aren't being controlled for, and that's why they have such outrageous p-values that render their data insignificant. It's not that the data is insignificant or the fact that you're doing it is insignificant, it's just the way they design their studies, it's always going to be insignificant because there's just too much error built into the way they do these studies. It's very, very extremely poor science, and it's kind of upsetting when you look at these agronomy PhD programs and how they conduct these studies. They just don't build these studies very well where they control error. They can't come to any kind of conclusion other than an anecdotal opinion. And so it's kind of frustrating when you see that kind of level of research in what should be So that's when you say farmers, like, they'll say, like, on our farm, you know, it's all anecdotal, because the research that's out there from institutions is just not well-constructed studies to come to these conclusions. You know, for example, like, rolled versus unrolled, like, the cost of rolling per acre, like, there's just too many other variables that they're not controlling. You have other things such as timing, moisture, organic index of soil. And so when you're comparing across one field to the other, I mean, they're not even remotely close to being similar, you know, in all these parameters for all these variables to be identical. You'd have to have all these land variables be consistent across the field to make comparisons like that if you want to narrow it down to this land roller made a significant impact. You just can't actually come to that conclusion, so it's kind of upsetting when they release conclusions like that, and that they have their end value is so low, and you know, it's self-reported surveys and you know, p-values, and they don't even cite their standard deviations in the article. And it's kind of embarrassing. I really do feel slightly embarrassed for these people that actually do this research. It's if it were to be submitted to any kind of peer-reviewed scientific journal, it'd be immediately denied. So I don't expect a lot of you guys to know a whole lot about that, but I've been studying high-level science for the past 8 years, so it's kind of what I do on a daily basis. So, for example, I've published in synthetic polypeptide synthesis, University of Wisconsin. The whole publishing process is, even at third author, it's really intensive, and it's they just don't let anyone get published. And, it goes against a whole panel of peer reviewed. But it's really hard. I mean, these are answers that people really want to know, because the answers to these questions, there's money tied to the answer to these questions. Should I roll? Should I not roll? Should I do mid pre? When should I do kind of side dress? When should I do this? What should be my organic index for water retention during drought conditions? What level of compaction? You know, hard pan. You know, all these unanswered questions that people want answers to, because they obviously want the highest yield. And I understand what these researchers are trying to achieve, but unfortunately, it's in these kind of retrospective longitudinal basically editorials or surveys, basically is what they are. It's a very low level of research. I mean, if you were to go to a meta-analysis stage, it's very high level research. But a lot of these things that I've been reviewing are just kind of really poorly designed retrospective longitudinal studies that really mean nothing in terms of coming to a definitive conclusion. But what really matters is your individual data. If you're doing, if you're farming and you have a field and you have all your information, you have your prescription maps, you have your yield maps from harvest, and you make change year after year, it's not you're making five different changes in your practice, you're making one change. Then you can see what kind of result is occurring from this one change. If you make one, more than one change, you have no idea if this one caused that effect or the other caused the effect. So in no other, you know, no research out there will really apply to your, no level of institutional research will be applicable to your individual land. But what they do is they should come, instead of saying it's a causation, or you should or shouldn't do, they should state that all else being equal, this does have this amount of benefit. Whether it's significant or not is irrelevant, because the amount of error that's built into these studies, the systemic error is going to always render it non-significant statistically. But I mean, if you get an extra 20, 10 bushels, say, an acre, or even an extra 5 bushels an acre from rolling your soybeans, well, extra 5 bushels an acre, that's a lot for a low yielding crop, you know. So that's what they should really determine is, you know, we can't really tell for sure with our land roller if our land roller is doing it, but I do know that I get an extra 5 bushel if I do. I have no way of actually proving if it's from the roller or if it's from culmination effects of land rolling and seeding early, or if it's a, you know, there's no way they can actually like weed out that it's this one practice that's doing all this kind of thing. The thing is, all these tillage and planting and nutrient application, all those things culminated together, and a lot of them work synergistically with one another, adding to a more combined effect that would be greater than either individual of them themselves. For example, like if you were to do seedbed finishing with a cultivator, okay, you get 5 bushels or 10 bushel an acre more. If you were to basically just roll the ground and not do like a fine seedbed, you get an extra maybe 5 bushel an acre. But if you do them both combined, you don't get 15, you get 20 bushel. You know, it's like, it's not an additive, it's a synergistic. I mean, they multiply off of one another. So it's really hard. And I don't blame these guys for trying to answer these questions, because they're big questions that need to be answered, because, you know, land is not growing. No one's building more land. The amount of land we have is what we got, unless you want to, you know, flatten mountains and cut up forests, which is, it's not going to happen. But so what you have to do is you just have to grow more bushels in the same amount of acreage. So these questions need to be answered, and there's people investigating it. And it's just right now the level of study and the mechanism of study and the way they design it is just, it's not something that I would say is very impressive. Not really anything that's relevant. You know, there's people that, you know, difference between conventional tillage or different shank rippers on soil moisture retention and compaction layer fractionalization. You know, all that stuff is, you know, you can actually see it. You can dig plot holes. You can dig and you can see and you can measure. That stuff you can visually measure, but I mean, over a duration of time of a grow season of multiple months, it's one practice versus the other, and then you're doing all these things mid-season. I don't even know how you would design something to even come close, remotely close to being able to design a study where you can say this has this effect, no question asked. But what you can do is you can think the theory of it. I mean, the whole point of rolling, and you know, certain seeds are more sensitive to certain depths, stuff like that. And you know, I think a lot of people use land rolling to protect their draper headers, not necessarily to improve yield, a better seed soil contact. But there's the theory and data to suggest that it yields a better seed soil contact, a better depth, a better average seed depth control if you do it before corn or like after beans and stuff like that. So anyways, rant of the day. It's just I've been looking at quite a few articles, not just agriculture, but dentistry and research and osseous integration and stuff like that. There's just absolutely horrendous, you know. There's not everyone is born to be a researcher in design studies. That are designed to actually answer your hypothesis, the question you're set out to answer. It's very hard to design a specific study to just focus on that certain variable if you really want to get to a causative conclusion. Otherwise, it's the issue with a longitudinal retrospective is you're looking at a lot of data that, you know, it's the same thing in medicine or dentistry or what have you. It's, you know, you look at all these different patients that kind of have the same disease, but, you know, they have all their systemic, you know, they're not the same person, and you're trying to wrap them all in the same group, but, you know, there's age. You know, you had to do stratification in your statistical analysis using ANOVAs and stuff like that. And I never see any of that kind of statistical analysis in any of these agriculture studies. It's very low-level statistical analysis that's involved. I don't even understand, because you have so many different variables that you're trying to control. So even a two-way ANOVA would try to help you kind of balance out that kind of discrepancy. It just doesn't happen. But it's kind of annoying, because you see everyone. I don't know if it's just like a lack of understanding, a lack of education, or a stubbornness, or thick-headed. I don't know what it is, but you see all the time like people that are like so brand loyal, like Ford's better than Chevy, or Chevy's better than her, blah, blah, blah. You know, it's all this kind of, like, imprinted ego, brainwashed, whatever, whatever you want to call it. It's just kind of annoying, because no one is actually doing any kind of critical thinking or investigating. They're just kind of going off of what marketing and media teams kind of spoon-feed them. And so it's just kind of really annoying that people don't even put their critical thinking hats on, or if they even own a critical thinking hat, to kind of question what they're reading or seeing or hearing. Always ask why, or always question. And if, you know, no one cares about your opinion, like, it's your opinion, that's great, but it's irrelevant. I don't care how you feel or think. I care what can be replicated, empirically, and proven. If you want to come to this is better than that. What does that even mean, and what in what sense of the word are you saying this is better than that, or this can outdo that? In what way, what function, and what exactly are you talking about? Because it's really annoying. It's the same thing as like people when they say like they're doing this, or they're doing that, or they're taking her jibs, and, you know, it's like, well who's they? First of all, who exactly are you, you know, specify who you're talking to, first of all. And then, you know, then they turn around and they say, you're an asshole, or don't treat me like an idiot. It's like, you know, you leave me no other choice. It's not my fault, it's yours. And I'm sorry you're being offended, but I honestly thought that you already knew. So that kind of stuff really kind of grinds my gears. So to speak, it's just the lack of thinking, and the lack of a thought process, and lack of the critical thinking and the questioning, having a curious mind. I was also watching a video of a guy that was doing a mod review of my Oxbow merger, and I've never seen such an epic fail in a mod review before. It was honestly like the most hilarious thing I've seen. He was comparing the Oxbow merger, the 334, the 3-section 34-foot, compared to the 8-game Chrome, and he's like, this only merges 10 meters and the Chrome does 18 meters. And it was was just a total, complete failed understanding of merging. You don't measure the working with the pickup. You measure the distance between the swaths. And if he would have done that, he would have realized that the in-game chrome biggest swath is a swath of 18 meters, and using the Oxbow merger, it's 22.2 meter swath. So it's significantly more material and more efficient. And I don't know, I literally just, all I could do is just shake my head and roll my eyes at like how terribly lack of understanding, and then here this guy is doing mod reviews. Yeah, and that's just kind of basically sums up why I don't release mods anymore, is because literally no one has a fucking clue what they're talking about. Not only do they not have a clue what they're talking about, they don't know how anything functions because they don't know how to script, they don't know even how to model, and yet they have the audacity to kind of do a mod review and criticize someone else's work. Not even criticism. I wouldn't even call that a criticization. I would just call that an embarrassment. But it's really annoying for me, and it's annoying for others, and that's why you don't see very many new mods being released. It's people just don't know what to do with them. They just straight up don't even know. I mean, you give someone that's used to driving say an 81 Honda Civic, a new Bugatti Veyron, they're fucking gonna break it. They won't even know what to do. They won't even know what kind of fuel to put inside of it. Because they're still on a mentality of a $30,000 or $30,000 a year income mentality instead of a multi-million dollar. You know, people just don't know how to handle nice things if they're not used to having it, or they themselves have never taken the time to acquire nice things themselves on their own accord. So that pretty much solidifies and summarizes why I don't release my work anymore. I mean, I had a guy that said my 2730 looked like a Kraus Dominator because it had 13 chains. Like, how honest retarded do you have to be? Like, like, beyond stupid is all I can say. And it's really annoying, and it's really unfortunate, because it just makes me more and more, less and less likely to release anything. Not that I'm supposed to release anything. It's the, I don't know why people kind of come to the mentality that just because I make something, I post a picture and a video of it, that it's going to be released. No, I mean, people post videos of their harvest or tillage or planting videos all the time, and you know, I watch those videos without the expectation that I'm going to be able to drive any of that or own any of that, or yeah. So I don't know where this kind of entitlement or this sense of this expectation or this assumption is, and that's unfortunate, because I think a lot of people kind of get put themselves in a situation to be disappointed based on their own kind of their own assumptions, and it's unfortunate, but not my problem. Never was, never will be my problem. So it's just kind of interesting how that the paradigm shift in this game has occurred. I don't really see it improving. Anyways, the Homer DLC is coming out. I do believe we're going to get it on the server. I mean, it's an insignificant amount of money. It'll be a nice little addition. I'm sure the new game that comes out is going to be stock part of that anyways. It'll be nice. I just don't like that they don't release these scripts. I wish the game was a little bit more open source. It's already pretty open source as is right now, but they keep a lot of the scripts they use on their DLCs kind of hush-hush locked up until maybe the next generation of game, or unless they release something else. But I would like to see how they set up the additional, like, sprayer and Brock spreader. I'm sure it's just, you know, an additional thing like the zoo hammer with the tillage and stuff like that. But I was thinking of putting attachable and detachable dry box and sprayer on my Rogator. so you only buy one machine, and then you kind of have like support arms that kind of extend when you detach it, so you can drive away underneath it. You can do it without any kind of script, so I was wondering if there's anything more specific to that. There are different steering modes, nothing new that was available in 13. It's available on the Euro Tiger, nothing new there. But it should be interesting to see how that functions. Anyways, sorry for being all kind of bitter and shit today. It's Saturday morning. Scheduled to have patients and neither of them showed up, so pretty kind of in an upset mood right now. Wasting my Saturday morning for nothing. And of course, these are patients that are the state pays for all their dental work and medicine, and of course, they're the ones that appreciate it the least and abuse the system the most. So that's another rant for another day. We're hooked up to this T9 just so we can burn up the remaining hours on this thing. We'll trade it in once it gets up to the 100 hours like our ATI. Still not sure if I want to get a row crop and buy another one of these T9 450 row crop, or if I want to get a 775E Challenger, because I'm sure that will be a good planting tractor, and that would also be a nice man the roller. That would also probably pull the DN345 pretty nice as well. So I don't know, let me know what you guys think. Another 450 row crop or MT775E Challenger. I never really wanted to make one of these land rollers, but so I'm like, what's the point, really? So you can see we have 1.1 million left. Lot to buy still. We need another Draper header, although I'm waiting on Julian's Macdon before that. Trade in the New Holland 45 to pick up the 45 Macdon. Have to buy another 2730. We have some debt that we should really pay off. We have land that we need to pay for. It's about $20,000 a day. No. About 250 an acre for the growth stage. So we're doing about 1260 acres. Then we also have land tax and income tax. almost get a second roller, really. But I think what we're going to be doing is we're going to be rolling and rolling and planting at the same time, or maybe tilling and rolling and all at the same time. So probably only have one roller going. Make a 90-foot roller, actually. Slap on like two more sections. I think it would be crazy going down the road. Anyways, guys, I'm probably gonna end the video here, so thanks for watching.